Roy Aitken is, by any measure, a Celtic legend. He is one of the youngest players to ever play for Celtic, making his debut as a 16-year-old in a League Cup tie at Stenhouse Muir in September 1975, coming on as a late substitute for Johannes Edvaldsen. By February 1976, he had established himself as a regular in the side. His breakthrough came under the guidance of Sean Fallon, while Jock Stein spent a year recuperating from serious injuries sustained in a car crash in the summer of 1975. He was initially played at centre-half, but when Stein returned to the helm in August 1976, he was concerned that Shirley, as he was known, was not yet strong enough to play that position. Aitken recalls in his book, Feed the Bear, that Stein created a position specially for him, just in front of the centre-backs. From then on, there was a great debate as to which was his best position, defence or midfield. By the early 80s, he was first-choice centre-half, but in the 1978-79 season, he was mainly played as a central midfielder, and there were few more exhilarating sights than the Bear rampaging from midfield with the ball at his feet, opponents bouncing off him in all directions as he bore down on goal. Even as a teenager, Roy Aitken was an inspirational figure in the Celtic team, and the foundations of his legend were laid at Ibrox in March 1977, where he scored two goals, the second a late equaliser that all but secured Celtic's first Premier Division title. The equaliser was also a stunning volley, and film of the match shows massed ranks of Rangers supporters celebrating what they thought was a win with scarves held aloft. Then the scarves quickly disappear as the ball hits the net and a fist-pumping Bear is swamped by his jubilant teammates.
Celtic won their first Premier League. Now they were after the Scottish.
By the mid-80s, Roy Aitken was Celtic's first-choice centre-half. But in the 1978-79 season, he was played mainly as a midfielder in front of Roddy McDonald and Johannes Edvaldsen. His legend was born in the final league match of the season when he dragged Celtic back into the game, scoring the equaliser after the sending off of Johnny Doyle and inspiring the team with a display of drive and aggression Rangers couldn't cope with. That match alone would have been enough to secure his place in Celtic history, but he would only add to it in the seasons to come.
Aitken again's made a great run into the middle. Roy Aitken there and scoring for Celtic, the equaliser, and it's Celtic 1.
There was no more thrilling sight than Roy Aitken rampaging forward from midfield, opponents bouncing off him in all directions as he bore down on goal. But there was much more to his game than effort and aggression. He had a surprisingly subtle touch and was a very good finisher, scoring 55 goals for Celtic. Not a bad return for someone primarily thought of as a defensive player.
The supporters are delighted. And the big player whom Celtic very badly missed and wins tonight shows exactly why. Playing in an attacking midfield role today, powering his way forward. And not only that, that was not an easy finish at all with the goalkeeper coming out. He did it immaculately.
A low point of Roy Aitken's Celtic career came in the 1984 Scottish Cup final when he was harshly sent off late in the first half, in a match Celtic would ultimately lose 2-1 to Aberdeen after extra time. He made up for this the following season though in the 1985 final against Dundee United. With Celtic trailing 1-0 deep in the second half, the Bear was unleashed from his defensive berth and suddenly the game was turned on its head as Aitken grabbed it by the scruff of the neck and drove Celtic on to a famous comeback. His surging run down the right wing and perfect cross gave Frank McGarvey the opportunity to head beyond the despairing Hamish McAlpine in the United goal. He richly deserved the Mr. Superfit award for the sponsor's man of the match.
Higgity spins, which Aitken returns, the header from McGarvey! Frank McGarvey! 2-1 to Celtic. McAlpine left without a hope. And this was Roy Aitken's contribution, winning the ball on the right, and that's a marvellous cross. McGarvey in his own, flying at the ball, the header beating McAlpine.
By the beginning of the 1986-87 season, Roy Aitken was made on-field captain, while Danny McGrain remained the club captain until his departure at the end of the season. The centenary season was perhaps Aitken's finest, as he led the club with distinction both on and off the field, exemplified by the home match versus Morton on the 27th of February 1988. As the game petered out to a scoreless draw, with Rangers about to cut the gap to 3 points, Celtic won a penalty kick in the final moments. With regular penalty taker Andy Walker out injured, players were looking at each other before Roy Aitken stepped forward and blasted the ball into the net for a vital 2 points. Paul McStay may have stolen the show that season, but Roy Aitken's defensive leadership provided the platform for the maestro to shine. Roy Aitken was by now the captain of Scotland, but he was not always popular with the gentlemen of the sporting press in Scotland. As the national side laboured to qualify for Italia 90, Aitken came in for relentless criticism, particularly from voice of a football Jerry McNee, and much of it crossing the line from the professional to the vitriolic and personal. Feeling under intense pressure, Aitken asked Celtic for a transfer and was allowed to join Newcastle United for a fee of £500,000 in January 1990. It was a sudden and totally unexpected end to a great Celtic career. In the space of 6 months, the club lost the experience of Mark McGee, Billy Stark, Tommy Burns, and now Roy Aitken. It left a gaping hole at the heart of the Celtic team that took the best part of a decade to fill. The dark times of the 1990s may have taken root the day Roy Aitken left. Roy Aitken is now a club ambassador, and few are more deserving of the honour.
Impeccable pass, lovely timing.